Okay, it's 2 o'clock. Welcome to my session. And this session we'll talk about application developments with OpenStack Swift. It's about programming on OpenStack to make OpenStack work for our applications, for our scenarios. I'm from Old Storage. Old Storage is a startup company which is provide object storage solutions for enterprises. So I'm a software engineer from Old Storage. And this company is located in China, Shenzhen, in Shenzhen City, China. So the core of Old Storage product is OpenStack Swift. So why we choose Swift? Swift is very mature. It is born at the very beginning of OpenStack. Now OpenStack have tens and hundreds of projects, but at the very beginning, there are only two projects. One is Swift, and the other is Nova. So and Swift can run on at very large scale. About this morning, 75 petabytes. It is very large scale, and in RackSpace actually, it runs on hundreds of petabytes. So it can run at very large scale and provide very high durability, very high scalability and availability. Yesterday there was a session. Which is delivered by Swift Stack. We know that Swift Stack is the main contributor of the OpenStack Swift source code upstream. So they explained why Swift can perform this better, this good. Swift is cool. Why? The architecture and how to install Swift. So I will not repeat this part. If you are interested in it, the endhood of OpenStack Swift, you can refer to the presentation yesterday by Swift Stack. So today, we focus on how to build application over OpenStack Swift. There are many applications in the real world that work on Swift. Swift is not so much related to virtual machines, different from other parts of OpenStack. So there are many applications in real world. We give some examples. The first one is eBay. We know that all these pictures are stored on in OpenStack Swift. And the other one is iQIYI. It is an online video site in China, like YouTube, similar to YouTube. So these pictures and videos, the source of these pictures and videos are stored in OpenStack Swift clusters. So these are internet applications and Wikipedia. Wikipedia are also a user of OpenStack Swift. And the right one is interesting, because in China, debit card need to be applied on-site. You need to go to bank. You cannot apply debit card remotely. So you need to go to bank. The process will be was very long. It will cost you about an hour to get a card. So this bank, it is also a very large bank in China Commercial Bank. So that developed a system. So this machine, it is not an ATM. This machine located in banks, and you go to banks, you want to apply for a debit card. You do not you do not need to spend so long time. You just stand in front of this machine, and a staff will see you remotely on that screen, see you remotely, and he will talk to you and ask you for some information and capture these videos and recording your sounds and store them in object storage system. So including your fingerprint maybe and your signature, the image of your signature. So you can get your debit card in less than 10 minutes. So it is the time decreased from 1 hour, about 1 hour to 10 minutes, thanks to the cloud computing and cloud storage. So this is very interesting. And I intended to show you a mobile app on iPhone, but unfortunately I cannot access to the Git server of my company. I don't know why I cannot log in and access my code. So I cannot demonstrate the iPhone application. But I wrote a very simple, but something like it. It is based on a command line, but it will help us to illustrate, to understand the how to develop an application based on OpenStack Swift. So talking about application development, OpenStack Swift is object storage. What is the difference between develop an application based on object storage and traditional storage, such as file system? The APIs are different. APIs are different. Object storage use RESTful HTTP APIs, and traditional storage like file system use the POSIX APIs. They're very different. For example, we cannot just overwrite or change only one part of a file. In file system, we can change a part of a file. But if we use object storage, we can upload a file to the object storage, so we call it an object. So we can upload an object, download an object, override it, but we cannot change only some part of this whole storage. So this is the difference. And there is something else. So in one word, we do not have random writes. We cannot perform random writes on object storage. And something other, we need to access our storage over HTTP. This is very different from traditional storage, from traditional storage systems. So object storage is very suitable for internet applications because it talks on HTTP. So this is the first thing that it differs. So the next I want to talk about is the namespace. For object storage, it is flat namespace. We only have buckets. Now some object storage provide presentum directories, but that's not a true hierarchical namespace. So this is different. We cannot build directories and hierarchical and put a file in one of them. We only have buckets. This, why we do this? Because when we have very large scale storage system, the files are too many. There are tens of millions of files this would be very slow. This would be very slow, but that would be fast. And the performance will grow with the scale. With the scale. This is very interesting and very attractive to nowadays. We call it big data times. So this is the second thing that object storage differs from traditional storage. So let's see some look closer to the APIs. The first part is the endpoint or the URI of the cloud storage service. It is the IP and with the HTTP // and @0@0 port. And the second part is the account name. In Swift, usually an account is related to a tenant. Account related to a tenant. So if you are a user or one app is a user of an account, if a user of a tenant, he logged in, he can only see containers and cannot see account. Can't say account because account is related to tenant, or you can think it equals to tenant, but actually for a storage system there is it is not what we think about account username and password not that account but a storage space. Service space that equals to a tenant. And the third one is container name. Container name, we said that if we have account, we can create containers in this account. And we put objects into that account. So this is the overview of OpenStack Swift APIs. In the following, we will see some details about how to use these APIs. And first of all, we need to install OpenStack Swift environment. There are several ways to install OpenStack Swift environment. For example, follow the OpenStack installation guide manually to install OpenStack and Swift. But it is very complex and manual to install OpenStack. We know it is always go wrong, right? So we usually use some automatic deployment tools. Our company provide automatic development tools for OpenStack Swift for enterprise users and also does SwiftStack. So our company is very similar to SwiftStack, but it is in China for the China OpenStack users. And the third way is to install SAIO environment. SAIO is Swift All-in-One. Swift All-in-One is for development. It is very important. It's not for production. It's not for product, only for development. And it is, it will install Swift from source code. And talking about install from source code, we know that OpenStack have a project DevStack. So we can also install DevStack. We can also install Swift with DevStack. So I will show that. Okay, we can see this is the virtual machine based on VMware Fusion. So it is Ubuntu. If you are interested in it, if you have an environment based on Ubuntu, you can follow me to have a try. No, it is a normal DevStack environment. Yeah, I will show you the difference in the configuration file. It is a normal DevStack environment, and just download the code from GitHub DevStack. And the difference is that you need to edit local.conf file for Swift. So if you want to install an environment only for Swift, you may disable all other services, but only enable something like sproxy, sobject. So these services begin with s. Is Swift services. So actually, you do not need to, it is not a must to install Keystone and MySQL. So we can also delete them. Oops. And you may need to do something else, such as we know that Swift will store data with replicas, usually three replicas. But in a test environment or development environment, we do not need to. Sometimes we do not need so many replicas. So. Here we just set it to one, and in DevStack it was installed install Swift to use a loopback device, not an actual hard disk or SSD. It's just a loopback device that emulate disk. So the default size of this loopback device, this file, the default size of this file is 1 gigabyte. 1 gigabyte, it is too small sometimes, so we can modify it. For example, here we use 20 gigabytes. So we can perform stack.sh. I'll just mention that here we use the branch liberty. We use the liberty branch. Sorry?
After changing the config for the Swift, do you need to unstack it?
Okay, this is a new environment, so we do not need to. So if we, I would like to repeat the question. The question is, if you change the configuration file, do we need to stack creator and stack creator again? The answer is this is a new environment, so we do not need to do that. However, if there are some services running, so we need to unstack it first. Now we can see it is finished. And different from we usually see after dev stack running, we do not see the username and password and other things, just the IP address. Because we do not enable Keystone. We do not enable Keystone. And Swift do not rely on Keystone to perform authentication. This we will explain later. Sometimes we need to develop authentication service that according to our customers' needs. So to verify this this installation, we can perform some operations. First of all, I would like to minimize this. Okay, this would be better. So here it is. This is another virtual machine. So we will use it as a client. And the one that runs DevStack as the server. So this is in the client. And the virtual machine we have seen before is a server. So most of our operations will perform on the client. So we're talking about developer applications, not operations and administration. So we just use the client. That's OK, the client environment. I will type in some command and show the results. And later, I will explain why the result. So first, I run Swift stat. Swift stat will give us the basic information about Swift cluster. Actually, it is about account in a Swift cluster. This account is, now this account is temp auth test. The account name is temp auth test. And Swift list. This command will list the containers under this account. You can see first we run Swift list and we get nothing. And then we run Swift post. Swift post will create a container and data account. So then Swift list again, we get A. This is the container. And we can upload object to this container. So we also run Swift list, but this time we put the name of that container in the command line. And we can see that the file we just uploaded, its name is test.rc in that container. So why it is act like this? Because first of all, source test.rc, let's have a look at test.rc, what's in it. So there are Swift users, ST user, ST key, and ST auth. This auth URL is different from Keystone. This auth URL is different from Keystone that we know that if it is a Keystone service, it should be on port 5000 and with version 2.0 and tokens and so on. Okay, but this is different. So in our environment, we do not install Keystone. Our authentication is performed by another authentication service named Tempos. Tempos we can think it as a demo for authentication service that we can develop. We can develop other authentication. We can integrate other authentication service into Swift. Follow the demo of Tempos. This we'll talk later. I'll talk about it later. So now let's see how these command lines call the APIs we mentioned before. So these are command lines. These are command lines. Now we have a look at it, how it called the APIs. These are the APIs. So what are the relation between them? Okay. Okay, the question is, how we configured the client to connect to the server, right? Okay, just source this file, and we can export the environment variables, the three environment variables. So we have a Swift authentication URL, Swift users, the name of Swift users, the password of the Swift user, ST key is the password. So we use command line. The command line will look for these environment variables and use them to log in to connect to Swift. We add a debug here. And we can see that the API calls here. We can see the API calls here. So compared to the slides before, we can see that this is the URL of the storage service. And this is the account name. This is the account name. And this is the container name. So and the action is get. So we get what? We get a list of the objects in that container. Okay. In the body of the response. In the body of the response. So this is the API call under the command line. So we just copy this and pass it directly. And we can see clearly that there is one object with the name test.rc. We just upload it here. So do we have a laser pen? Nope. Here. So I'm near-sighted, so I cannot see that clearly. This is the object name. This is the object name. It is the same as we just uploaded. And we can see the these are the header. These are the headers of the response. You can think it of some meta information of the container A. So the key point is that a user will know his username, the tenant name, and the location of the storage cluster, the location of the storage cluster here. This is the location of the storage cluster, and the user also knows the tenant name and the username. But in this API call, this is very important. In this API call, we do not see the tenant name directly, and we do not see the username. The account, we say account is related to a tenant, but the tenant name, you can see that. The tenant name is the test. Tenant name is test. And the username is tester. So this is the format of the tempos authentication service. It is used as the Swift user means the first one is tenant name, and the second one is the username. And actually, a user or a developer would know these informations, including the password, but he did not know what is the actual name of the account. And in this API call, there is no username and password, no username and password. So the question is, how did a developer to get the account name? How do he get this account name? And how to get authenticated? So get verified is get verified. So this, as other OpenStack services, use tokens. So the question is, how a developer can get the token? So let's see this command again, swift stat. We said that with this command, one can get basic information about his account and basic information about his account. So we add the v parameter here. So we can get some more information listed here. So actually it is perform another API call, which is here. Let me see. It called this command line, called this HTTP API before first, and get two variables. The first one is storage URL, and the second one is auth token. So subsequently, other command line will use this, other operations will use these two variables. Let me see. So how does the Swift stat get other informations? Here. So it called this API and get the storage URL and the auth token, and then use the storage URL here and the auth token to perform next steps. So in our development, we also follow this routine. We first get authenticated, get the token, get the storage URL, and then use these variables to perform next steps. We can see another command. So we create a container named Austin. We can see that it also did the same things. First, call this API to get the storage URL and auth token, and then use them. Use them to in next steps. Okay. First, in this command call, we can see that there is a error. There is an error because it first check that whether this container already exist. If it already existed, it will not create a container with the same name. It will fail. Okay. So it checked it before, and find that it returned not found, which means the container Austin does not exist. So did not exist. So he create the container Austin. In this step. So we can have some try that
thank you.
So we should remember that at the very beginning, we only know the authentication URL, the auth URL, and the tenant name and the username. So we just use these three information to get others. OK, this is a short program. This is a short program. We can see the source code, and I will demo the function here in this window. I need to do some modification that. Oh, this program is with Keystone. We can see that. We can see that if we need to create a container, first we need to get a token. And here is how we get a token and the storage URL with temp auth authentication mechanics. So here is the auth URL and it will put the username and the tenant name in the request headers, and send the request to the server and get the response. In the response, there are storage URL and auth token. So this is what happens when we do not use Keystone. And how about we use Keystone? We use Keystone. So temp auth is just a demo authentication service that help us to develop our own authentication mechanisms. So, but Keystone can be used in production. So let's see what would happen if we use Keystone. This is the machine. This is the virtual machine we ran DevStack before. We modify the configuration to add Keystone. So now we need to unstack it. Okay, and stack again. Very soon it will come up a Swift environment with Keystone. So Keystone installation will spend more time. Okay. So when we use tuples, when you use tuples, it is a very, very simple authentication middleware that it's very simple. So we add the username and tenant name in the headers, of our requests. And the token, if it is issued, it will not change. So it cannot be used in production. Okay, finished. So back to the client machine. Okay, and oops, it seems that I forgot something. Okay, that's okay. And I also need to enter the tenant name and usernames. This is what the program writes. So the first one, get a token, is just to show that this works. This works, and we can see the in the other functions how the token is used. So. We created a container and we list all the containers and we find that the test container is in it, is in our account. So we can see something different that if we use Keystone, the storage URL and the token are a little complicated. We still use this command, and we can see that the storage URL, it changed. Also, version 1, but the storage URL is more complicated, like some random number. Actually, this is the tenant ID. This is the tenant ID provided by Keystone. Let's see how it works. Where's my point? Okay, here. Okay. If we need, for example, if we need to list all the containers, or we need to create a container, if we need to create a container, we need to first get the token and the storage URL. And we call the function in the front that here. So this is a very simple program, but it is a little bit complicated that you need to call the auth URL to get the token and storage URL, then use them to actually perform operations to the storage cluster here. Get the storage URL and the auth token first, and then call the storage URL with the token. And here is just a RESTful API calls. You can use whatever framework you like. I use requests is Requests is a framework that help us to make HTTP calls in Python. It is very simple if you use something before, like your lib URL lib 2, you will know that this will be more simple than before. So just perform HTTP calls. It is the routine first to get the storage URL. Remember that as a developer, he did not know the storage URL, but he need to get it from the authentication service, and then call the actual APIs of the storage service. Why it is designed like this? Because this makes a storage cluster, a Swift cluster, can use more than one authentication mechanics. For example, it can use tuples at the same time use Keystone. So the prefix of the storage URL will be different. The prefix will be different. For example, if we use Keystone, the prefix is auth. But if we use tuples, the prefix will be tuples. So if we have a third authentication mechanism, we can use another prefix. So if we create a container, if we need to create a container, first we get the storage URL and ask the user to input the name of the container, and then create the container. Before we create the container, we need to check if this container already existed. So this is the routine. But there are something we should take care of. For example, if we do not successfully connect to the server due to network interruptions, do we need to try again? How many times do we need to try again? And if we get some status code indicate something goes wrong, how do we handle them? How do we handle them? So these are the questions we need to take care of. So when we develop application with direct API calls, it will be more complicated than we see here. More complicated. We need to make our application robust. So we need to do more work. So it is. Sometimes it is goes more and more complicated, and still have some bugs. So in production code, we usually use SDKs or libraries, but not use direct API calls. Direct API calls, we can write some program to make direct API calls to help us to understand how this works. But in production, we use libraries and SDKs. For Swift, there are Python bindings, Python libraries, and also Java libraries and .NET libraries, and JavaScript maybe. I do not remember clearly. Ruby, yes, Ruby SDKs. So we in production we will use SDKs and libraries and bindings. So and here we will show you that if we use Python library. Or the official, yes, it is the official library that the OpenStack provide. The official Swift library, the Python library. Let me see. So here, we can see that in the manual, I designed I implemented two items with the same name, create a container. But the underlying code are different. We can see that a moment ago, we see that with direct API calls, the code will be a little complicated, but with libraries, only these lines from here to here did all the things to create a container. We do not need to call the authentication API. We do not do to store the storage URL and authentication token in a variable or something else, and we do not take care of if we failed to connect to the server, if we failed to send HTTP request to the server, do we need to try again? We do not think these things because the libraries take care of them. So it is very simple. It's very simple. Actually, only three lines. First, make a connection to the Swift cluster, then put container. Just use this function, put container. That's okay. We do not need to write that many codes. And after that, we close this connection. So a container is created. We can have a help us to see this clearly, that so we compare them to do the same thing with direct API calls, write so many codes. And so many codes, maybe something we do not take care. And with the libraries, only three lines to do all of the things. So this is the difference between the direct API calls and the programming with SDKs. So in this slide, we see that more clearly. If we use client libraries, we only need to write three lines to do all the operations to create a container. And if you want to read more information about the Python client libraries for Swift, visit that URL. So we can have a look. So this page. This document is generated from code, so it is not very readable, but read it carefully and you can get it. So this is the basic function that we can use in the development. Create a container, read data, write data, and put, get, and delete data, delete containers. These are the basic operations, but there are something other than that. For example, this photo is I took yesterday at the keynote sessions. And we can see on the right, there are some informations with which device I took this photo. It is an iPhone. And the size of this photo and the location where I took this photo. So this we call it metadata. In file system, metadata usually indicates that the directories, the tree of the file system. But in object storage, metadata usually refer to these informations. They usually be very useful because only a photo is not enough. We need some more information to describe this photo. So these are also in the, if we need to implement something like this in when we're programming with Swift, how we can do? Swift provide an API or something like an API called metadata headers. We put a header begin with X and meta in the middle. And we can add some metadata to containers, to account, to objects. Let's see how it works with command lines. Oh, we always see this warning. This is because in Liberty, Swift client use API of the Keystone client, and it is not recommended to use that. Keystone do not recommend to use that API. So it always trigger this warning. This is not because our code or our command line. It is because the Swift do not use the best API of Keystone. Or Swift client do not use the best API of the Keystone client. So in this container test, there is an object demo, and we also can use Swift stat. We can use Swift stat. We can use Swift stat to account. We also can use Swift stat, this command. It is very, very useful when we debug some programs. We can also use this command line to a container and to an object. So you can see these are the informations about this container, about this object. We can add some some metadata to it. Okay, the format of the metadata is here, is shown here, the format of the metadata. We add a location. Then we can see that in the information here, there should be a here location. Location appears here. So yep. Highlight the location on the map, you need to do more programming with the LBS service or map service. So just add some metadata on it. We can also do something more. Yep. You add metadata to the photos, to the documents, to anything you uploaded to Swift, and you can use the other services related. Yep. Yep. Yep, you can use, for example, you can use this location, input this location to a map service, and it will highlight the point, highlight all certain in that map. So here we can see that there is a metadata called topic. Yep. Yep. So we can use different metadata to describe this different metadata to describe our objects. Describe our objects. So this is about the metadata, and. Similarly, this is in command line. So, how we how we do it when we programming, we can see that with debug. Oops. Here. Just add a hat. Just add a hat in front of a body. Just add a hat in the request. And the hat with the X and object means this is a metadata. This is a metadata for an object, and matter. And this is the key of the metadata. This is the key of the metadata. So you can add OpenStack as the topic of this object. And this operation is performed by post. So we use put to upload an object into Swift. We use get to read an object out of Swift. We use delete to delete an object. And we use post to update the metadata. We should be careful that with post, we can only update metadata, but we cannot overwrite the object. If we need to overwrite object or we need to modify our object, we need to use put, the put request, but not the post request. The post request only modify metadata. And actually, metadata can do something more. For example, quotas for container. If we add this metadata into a container, it will limit the size of this container. How many bytes, how many files, how many objects you can put into a container. This will be useful when in some scenarios, user may put millions of files into one container. That will make this container very slow. So sometimes we need to use quota to limit this, to limit these things. And sometimes we also need to expand the function of OpenStack Swift because the APIs the Swift provided to us does not satisfy our needs. So we need to expand the functions of Swift. It is not very hard because Swift, the API of Swift is implemented based on WSGI. So WSGI, we can think of it as a pipeline. And a request come into the pipeline and modified by one and another filter and output the last request and to the finally proxy server, and the proxy server return the response, and the response goes through all these filters to the end of the pipeline and to the client. So why we can use Keystone? Because we add this. This is Keystone. We can make authentication with Keystone and tuples. We can make authentication with tuples. And we can also add our own authentication mechanism into this pipeline. And in the Swift cluster, we can use more than one authentication method. We can use many. So in some scenarios, some containers need to be accessed by, for example, fingerprint or iris authentication, and some just code. That's okay. So we can use different authentication method to add our own middleware or filter. It depends on where you use this in the WSGI context. So here are some other things that I want to mention, that Swift nowadays do not only support small files, but also support very large files very well. The throughput can be achieved to about 1 gigabytes per second, 1 gigabyte per second or more, depends on the network. Depends on the network. So how to upload big files to this high throughput? We split a file into segments, and the segment size can be limited, can be indicated in command line with a parameter segment size. And how we use it in when we program, when we do programming. So we upload this file with 50 megabytes and split it into segments. So we can upload it different paths apparently. We also use, make it output the debug information. Okay, we can see that Swift uploads every segment as a single object, and at last it uploads a single object with 0 byte. So we call it a manifest. So it describes how actually this object is consists of different segments. So let me see. So we can see there is another container, test segments. And actually the data is stored in this container, but not the container test. So these are the data. There are 6 of them, and everyone is about 10 megabytes. And in the test container, we can see that actually the file, the object 50m.file is 0 byte. The size of it is 0 byte because it is just a manifest. It's just a manifest. It indicates that the Swift, that the data are actually stored in another container. So this is how we process, how we store and upload big object. And Actually, Swift, the data in Swift can not only be accessed via proxy server, but also from storage server directly. So the API are very similar. Okay, so we can directly read this object. We can directly read this object from the storage node. This is very flexible because sometimes we want to make our data processing program run directly on the server where the data are stored, but not via the API from proxy server. In another word, in Swift, you can do data locality with this API that read data from the storage nodes. There are many other features that we can use in our application development, and if you are interested in it, you can read the official documents on OpenStack site for Swift. So that's all. Thank you very much, and thank you. If you have any further questions, you can email me, or you use WeChat, you can contact me with WeChat. Okay.